So we've spent well over $100,000 in months of meticulous planning on a single skylight. Let me walk you through why. So we're at our 45 White Oak project. This is an ultra luxury spec home that we're building in Wellesley. Things like the skylight are really part of the commitment, not only to the vision of the project, but the vision of our brand behind craftsmanship, behind design, behind really elevating what we're trying to build here. So we actually partnered with Glazing Vision on this really for four reasons: for customization, for durability, for performance, and for the frameless design. So the unit itself is actually 9 foot by 9 foot and weighs 1,300 pounds. So it was really important to make sure that we hit those parameters in terms of overall size. It is made up of two layers of glass. It's a double pane unit. From a performance aspect, it actually performs better than a typical double glaze unit. It actually has a U value of 0.19, which is really great for a double unit. It did not require us to go to a triple glaze, which oftentimes triple glaze is gonna get you a 0.15 to a 0.2. So we're right in that parameter at a really high performance double glazed piece of glass. From the frameless perspective, we really wanted this to feel as though the sky was attached to that first floor. When you're down in the first floor, which will be the future dining room, you really only get the view of the sky. Now, up behind me is actually the only view in this house that you actually see any vegetation through the corner. If you come out of the secondary bedrooms, you capture the tree just beyond the glass, but everywhere in the house, you only see sky. The glass itself actually has a protective coating, and it's actually to help keep it clean. So as it rains, the water is going to essentially bead off of that glass. And a detail that would be really hard to capture anywhere really in the home, except for up on the roof, it's actually installed at a 3-degree pitch. So water does not only bead, but it also runs off of that. So from a maintenance perspective, you're not getting it up there and really having to clean it very often. So installing a 1,300 pound skylight takes a lot of consideration, especially from a structural perspective and just a logistical perspective. Early on in the design, we were working with Vincent and the team at Upossible about this skylight and what it looked like. Conversations around whether we would do this in a single piece or we would divide it up, and ultimately ended up with a single piece because we really wanted that uninterrupted view up to the sky. That led to a really challenging design in terms of how we were to support the roof. You know, we do have this parapet roof structure, but with a 9 foot by 9 foot opening, you can imagine that you have these massive beams that are holding that skylight, not only for the 1,300 pound skylight, but also for the live load and snow load that's going to be up there. Skylight is not walkable, it's considered serviceable. All of that weight actually has to transfer down into the space and down into the structure of the home. So a lot of that had to be considered really early on in terms of how we were going to support this. Not to mention the fact that we also have this masonry cladding, the Peterson cover brick, that is suspended underneath the skylight. So you have to take all of those things into consideration when you're designing this, not only aesthetically, but structurally. This home was panelized. Cape Cod Panel built this in the shop. So a lot of that was all predetermined in the model. We had LVLs up there, we had LSL posts, came down to a steel beam. All of that had to be considered when we were modeling this home and then ultimately framing it on site. Now, prior to installing the skylight, we had to be really careful and work with Glazing Vision to make sure that we were building a curb that would port the skylight to where we needed to from an elevation standpoint. So they worked with us and developed a shop drawing set to essentially show us how to build the curb and the size of it, but also the pitch of it. I talk about having a 3-degree pitch to let the water run off. That's all built within the curb for the skylight. Prior to the skylight showing up, we actually had our TPO roof run up the curb, and then we actually taped that roofing to the curb itself to make sure that we had a really nice weatherproof seal. Now, Glazing Vision did come out for the installation. They were here to oversee the installation. One of the challenges that we faced actually on site, we originally had a suction cup planned to be on site, to which we did, but found out at last minute, unfortunately, that the cup was not strong enough to hold up a 1,300 pound piece of glass, especially in the horizontal orientation. Thankfully for us, CJ Shaughnessy actually was able to get a crane on site with some slings, and we actually strapped it and lifted it up to the roof and placed it onto the curb. Made it a little bit of challenging and required some handwork. We had to actually lift it up by hand and put some dunnage under it. And in doing that, we end up running our beads of silicone. Now, the beads of silicone sit on top of that curb and allow the skylight to be lifted up and then dropped down on top of the curb, creating a continuous waterproof seal. Now there's some integrated bubble gaskets that are in that skylight seal itself. Being that it's such a minimalist skylight, it's really just glass and then this stainless steel powder coated frame with some gasketing, and really relies on that additional sealant as well. Last thing would be to anchor everything back to the structural curb that we built, and then that skylight is installed. There's these moments in construction where you install it, you step back and you really appreciate it, and how much different something looks. Interestingly, for the skylight, it didn't do anything. We put the skylight on, we came back down, we looked up, it looked exactly the same, which on one hand is just kind of funny because you would expect it to make this big dramatic change, but on the other hand, it's like, well, that's exactly what we wanted. We wanted connection to the sky with it feeling as though there was not a piece of glass there. That we looked at doing this in multiple units, or can we use a stock unit and basically mull them together? And ultimately we opted to go with the single piece of glass. Now, naturally, a 9 foot by 9 foot piece of glass is not inexpensive. That skylight is very expensive compared to what a traditional skylight would look like. We think about the design of this home and the experience of the home and how someone's going to interact with the home when they live here, when they visit here. And these are the small moments that we pay a lot of attention to and really partner with great architects on and know what that looks like for the end user. This, you know, there's going to be a dining room below. It's your main entry. And as people are walking through this space, we want people to have this, oh, wow moment. The other side of it is we want really high quality materials and high quality product in a home like this. So the skylight's all installed and we came inside and we essentially framed out what is the portal of the dining space and the entry space. So the skylight itself is 9 foot by 9 foot and it tapers down to this larger square opening. Across from me, this wall here is perfectly vertical. So those shingles, the Peterson cover brick, are installed just like they are on the outside of the home. The wall across from me and directly above me are actually on a slight angle. You can see it here. But the interesting thing is that those shingles are actually now hanging almost perfectly plumb. So they're installed very similar to the wall that is plumb, but the shingles themselves end up plumb rather than the wall. But this one is more challenging. This one is essentially being hung upside down. So these shingles had to be considered, we had to be really considerate on how we installed these shingles. Before we get to this wall, I want to kind of walk you through the other three. I mentioned that one is just straightforward. We go all the way up and you have that last course. What you'll notice is, you know, typically you have screws that are protruding on that, on every shingle that get covered by the next row. But up there, the guys did a really great job where they actually countersink the screws at the very top. They were actually able to mix a little bit of adhesive and the dust from cutting this brick to fill in the screw holes at the very top. From this point, you actually can see just the frame of the skylight, which is clad in that stainless steel, which is just a machine finish, which is really nice because it's kind of a dull stainless steel. So in a bright day like today, you do get some reflectiveness, but in a more cloudy day, it really mutes the metal out. So this is just installed on a horizontal batten system all the way up. We actually installed two return air pieces of ductwork. And why we did that is essentially you have heat that rises and can get trapped up in the skylight. So one return actually ties into the primary suite system, and this return ties into bedroom 2 and 3's system. And what happens is as the second floor is conditioning itself, it's gonna be pulling any of the hot air from up in the skylight and bringing it in and then conditioning it. There is no grooves or any reveals in the shingle itself. Because of the natural handmade material, you do have a ton of undulation in those shingles. And frankly, you're gonna get just kind of passive airflow through those shingles themselves, and we'll be able to capture that heat. Now, we're not looking to capture all of the heat, we're just trying to capture and condition as much as possible to keep the home comfortable, because that will essentially be an area that heat does get trapped. This section here where we are upside down, these shingles, you know, we did actually a handful of tests on how we would install these. So we ran all the horizontal strapping and we installed them with just screws. We actually had, I think, 4 screws or so in that shingle, and we were able to hang from that shingle with no issue. They were actually able to support my entire weight. We didn't feel as though we'd have any concern structurally with hanging these upside down, but we wanted kind of a belt and suspenders approach. So we actually worked with our sheet metal fabricator and we ordered some perforated sheet metal. So what we did is we actually bent kind of like an S-clip, and we use construction adhesive on the back of those shingles and place that sheet metal into the backside of the shingle, let that set up overnight, and then when the next day we are actually able to take the shingle and slide them up, and that bottom part of the sheet metal actually clips onto the top part of the previous row. Now you can see as they're being installed, they're actually now self-supporting. You wouldn't even need screws. So by using a clip like that and the screws, again, we go back, we kind of have that belt and suspenders approach to keeping those in place and up there. Lastly, I really want to call attention to the job that the carpenters did with the interior fins. Our team painstakingly built these fins one by one, each corner, and being that you have kind of this, what I call a bastard hip or a reverse bastard hip, in the sense that you're not on the outside, you're on the inside, where you have two angles coming in that are not the same angle, you know, you have to be really intentional with how that sheet metal gets bent. What I'll say is kudos to Patrick and Tyler from our team in working through that, building templates, and then working with our sheet metal shop to fabricate these really gives it kind of that last finished touch, just like the outside of the home. Now, I want to address one of the questions that has come up quite a bit is, well, why don't the shingles line up in the corners? And of course, the answer would be because they're not on the same angle. As this one rotates down, your horsing is going to get tighter as it works its way up, which really plays into the reasoning that sheet metal fin makes such a great detail in the corner for those to tie in, you know, completely individually, but relate to one another as they work their way up. So this skylight, like I said, is really one of the first things that you see when you walk in this home. It's incredibly important to get right. And like, you know, I had mentioned it, we spent well over $100,000 and weeks and weeks and weeks of working through the details on this skylight. And to think whether or not this was worth it, I personally think it was for a home of this stature.